Can you imagine my shock and my feelings yesterday when I finished the live streams after announcing to all of you that yesterday was the last sunrise of the year, and then the first WhatsApp I met was exactly that it was not the last one, it was the second last one. I was distracted. There are a couple of reasons why that happened, I think, but anyway, it doesn't matter. I was felt so ridiculous. But you have another last sunrise in this year, so this is all for you, an extra one. Long ago in the stores where there weren't any supermarkets at least in the west of Ireland, when I was growing up, and sometimes the store man would put in an extra potato in the bag or an extra whatever, and it felt so good to get an extra one. So now we have an extra an extra sunrise in 2023. Part of the reason was that over here at this little tent that all of our guests were staying here long term because of all the problems here, they had a party for New Year's on Friday night, which I didn't hear at all, thanks be to God, because it was very loud music, but somehow I didn't hear any of it. And they had a huge 2024 on it, and I was half tempted yesterday to start the live stream there, but the sun hadn't come out yet, so I just kept going further south into the park, and I did it there. So that's how that was. And on this day of the year, we usually spend a day in retreat, or a portion of the day, thanking the Lord, reviewing all the blessings of the year, counting our blessings, reviewing our blessings. There was a huge 2024 pasted on here, or attached here, but it's gone now. It's cleaned up, you know. And there were a lot of streamers here, and there was hardly any wind, but the streamers were blowing in the wind. Oh, there go our ducks. Yesterday, did we see our ducks yesterday? Was that on Instagram? They're over here. Not ducks. I keep calling them ducks. They're Egyptian geese. Egyptian geese. So to thank God for all the blessings, and not just to receive the blessings as such, but to make a list of the blessings from this year. Make a list of them. And the second step is to see how God was working in you through the blessings he gave you. See how God was working in your life. Because God is working in our lives all the time, and he's working. He doesn't normally send us fax or emails or stuff, and he doesn't come online and show his face, but he's always with us. And he's the one, he's the giver of the gifts. And to see what's he up to, you know? The other day, one of our confreres, or he's visiting here for a little while, one of our people here brought him a gift of the Hebrew letters because he wants to learn some Hebrew. So it wasn't just to see the letters, it was to learn the letters. And he's very happy with that because it's helping him. Hebrew letters are a little bit of a challenge, you know. They look very different. They don't look as bad as Chinese, but there's a little closer familiarity with the Semitic letters. But you want to learn them, you know. And so that gift is for a purpose. It's for a purpose. You hang little things in front of the child, not just to decorate the little place where the child is, but so that they start touching them and they see the colors, and it stimulates their sensory, and it stimulates also their motor capacity, because they have to move them and they touch them and they make noises. And so the child is stimulated, and all the favors and blessings that we receive are stimulations from God. And what's very good is that we wake up to what God is doing to some extent, because what God does is also a mystery and we won't figure it all out. But to some extent, you know, there's a certain awareness, a certain alertness to what God is actually doing. And then we can help a little more with that process and not block it. That's kind of part of the idea of this exercise. And then a second point to do is to think about all the difficulties and all the challenges and some bad things that have happened in our lives. We have a confrere who was visiting in Mexico and he got the famous Montezuma's Revenge, and it was a bad case, and they took him to hospital for a check, and it turned out that he had something else, some other major complication that he hadn't even noticed, and he was due to head to another country. And in that process they discovered this through that difficulty he had, and by that difficulty he was blessed. Actually, I had another case of that personally myself. I was traveling with there were two sets of us in Nebraska doing mission appeals back in the 1980s, mid-1980s, 40 years ago, can you imagine? And 40 years ago, mid-80s. And there was a fellow who was as old as this priest is now, was driving out of a side road onto, it wasn't a freeway, but it was a four lane with a lot of freedom to move, very little traffic lights. So you were traveling at probably 55, 60 miles an hour. And this guy gets distracted. He's about 80 years of age. And a sports car went by or something, and that's the explanation he gave later. And he got distracted by it, and he just rolled out in front of them. So obviously brakes went on, screeched, you know, but there was impact. And our two priests obviously had quite the shock in the car. And this one hit this windscreen with his forehead. And actually the next day when I went to the scene, I found a bit of his eyebrow on this windscreen. He was red-haired, blonde red-haired guy. And he's still alive, and he's in the end of his life right now, actually. And he gave a nice little greeting for Christmas. And he's bedridden. And so he had lost a lot of blood, but when he got to the hospital, his blood pressure was normal. And with normal blood pressure, what happened? Well, they said that he had lost a lot of blood. He had to get a lot of blood pumped into him, and then it was discovered that he had massive blood pressure, and he had no idea. And a little sense like that, God works in our lives through the difficulties. Through bigger difficulties, through smaller difficulties, through financial difficulties, through challenges in relationships, through... I have a hard time going through here because I'm kind of all blocked. Through all kinds of things, and I can't get through. So he had to take remedy for his blood pressure. And that's what happens to us in our lives. God is working on us. And to discover God's working on us, maybe I get very angry over a disappointing situation, but I need to stop and think, well, why am I getting so angry? And next thing, God is alerting me to other areas of my life in which I need to grow. I need to grow. That's the whole point of the game. So everything that God allows in our lives is to help us to develop. Some people are always complaining about some aspect of their life, professional aspect, career prospects, industry goes downhill, COVID strikes, college is interrupted because of bereavement, it's very hard to go back and resume, or there's some things I have to take care of for the family and I can't go back and study. Turns happen in our lives, and God is very involved. And this is a great time in life, the end of the year, the last day, or a birthday. When you have your birthday is a good time, because it's kind of a year turn. Or when you have round birthdays, it's a bigger time to look at your life. And that's one of those moments. And Abraham was having one of those kind of moments probably in our first reading today. And he's complaining to God that he doesn't have any children. And Eliezer, his steward, is going to inherit his land and his flocks, because he doesn't have land yet. And he knows where his land should be, but he doesn't. Abraham dies, actually, owning a cave with graves for Sarah and for more of the family and for himself down the road. So that's how Abraham dies. He doesn't have his promise fully received yet. So he's in a complaining mood with God. And God takes him out and shows him the stars. You know the story. What's happening? Abraham is growing in faith. And that's our second reading. How Abraham was formed by God through the trials. So check out your blessings for this year. Check out your trials. And see how God is transforming you. He's transforming each of us into a major work of faith. A major work of hope. A major work of incredible love, of mercy, of respect for others, of service, of overcoming judgmentalism, of the need to get a new theology if the theology I have allows me to hate people. God is working in my life. God is working in Abraham's life and Sarah. And he's working, not just giving them a child. Actually, there's a very nice, interesting thing about Eliezer. It struck me. It says that Abraham's complaining to God and says, Eliezer, my steward, is going to take all my property. And that throws light on Herod's steward. You remember Herod's steward here in Tiberias? He's in the gospel because the steward's wife is a disciple of Jesus and a close buddy of Mary Magdalene. Because it says Jesus was supported, Luke chapter 8 verse 3 or 2, that he's supported by these women, Mary Magdalene, Susanna and Johanna, the wife of Herod Stewart. So that means Chusa is actually the top guy in Herod's palace. He's got everything under his authority. And it's like the keys of the kingdom as well. That term is used. And that tells us a lot about the social level of the people around Jesus here at the Sea of Galilee. Okay, there were fishermen, there were farmers, there were sick people, lepers, there were prostitutes maybe, there were, you know, people, all kinds of people, but there were also people from very high society. The top level, the top drawer. It's just interesting because everybody is called to this transformation by grace. Everybody. Everybody. And today is a very big day. We remember the family. So it's about family. And there we have another big lesson. You know, Abraham and Sarah don't have a child. And unfortunately today, with all of the development and all of the good nutrition and all of the understanding we have and all the great science, many people have huge fertility issues. But the big teaching of all of this by Abraham and Sarah and many other cases throughout the scriptures is that actually God is the author of life. God is the author of life. And many parents pray for a long time. Maybe they have moments like Abraham and Sarah that they're longing for a child and saying to God, what's going on? There's also a great abuse of sexuality in our time. And then that also causes major damage. And then the fertility is really damaged. So there's sometimes some people, I think, bear the burden of infertility as a way of reparation. To recognize God as the author of life and to develop that incredible love and insight and respect for God's handling of life. God is the great author of life, the great giver of life. God blesses us with life. And we see that with Hannah, the mother of the prophet Samuel. We see that with Zechariah and Elizabeth. There's so many cases to discover that God is the author of life. And in your family, look, think of your children. You didn't make them. Think of your grandchildren. You didn't make them. You didn't get them at the supermarket. They are from God. They are made in His image and likeness by Him. and they're entrusted to you, and you have a great part, and he allows you. There's a wonderful word that was probably much more familiar in our minds before, that the parents are procreators. God is the creator, and they are in a very special place of collaboration with God in the development of life. And then we have all the challenge of a newborn, and Joseph and Mary have to go to Egypt. They have to flee from Herod. There's so many provisions parents have to learn to make when they have a child. They really start thinking about the child. They're now no longer living just with their concern for their own immediate needs. They have to think about the child's needs. What a wonderful way to grow. And then there are siblings, and then there's the education of siblings, and there are mutual relationships, and the burden that is for parents sometimes when there are difficulties. Sometimes a child is born with great difficulties. The great role of family. Also, when people are aging. Yesterday I received the news of my mother's brother's widow. For many years, he passed away after my mother at the end of the 90s. So 25 years later now, his widow in her 90s passes away. And, you know, a very long life and great-grandchildren. You know, how many blessings in a family. And those moments are also part of the family. And grieving. Grieving. Nobody can mourn like a spouse or a parent for a child that passes away. And it's a special moment when children are mourning. Mourning for a parent, for a grandparent, also for a sibling. Those are hard moments when the first sibling is called to eternal life. And there's a whole lot in between birth and passage to eternal life. People, may you be blessed in your families today. May the Lord bless you and keep you and prepare you for a new year of God's blessings in our wonderful world that's so tested and tried by so many conflicts. And we pray that every human being in all of these and all of the families will receive blessing and consolation from God. See you later, alligators.